Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive Magazine and GI Plus. Thanks for joining us once again on a Monday evening where we are here hanging out talking about guitar. And today we are continuing our series on picking strategies where we discuss the technique and the picking approach of the high king of prog shred guitar, John Petrucci. I do like to make these things difficult for myself, apparently. So we are going to be talking specifically about John Petrucci's technical right-hand approach, specifically his alternate picking approach, in today's stream. However, if you want to do a deeper dive into John Petrucci's vocabulary, his rhythm playing, his tonal approach, we have a tech session regarding all of those topics that's available for you on GI+. I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a moment. First of all, though, let's just take a moment to check in with the stream, see how everyone's doing. We got some new friends, we got some old friends, so if you're joining us for the first time, do let me know in the comments section. I would love to hear from you guys. Also, as per usual, we'll be taking some questions a little bit later on, so if you have any questions, drop them in the comments and we will address your questions live on camera at the end of the stream today. So let's just take a quick check in, see how everyone's getting in. Roy Lisman says, rock on, Nick. This sentiment is echoed by, I'm gonna pronounce this as Lacree. I don't know. I'm terrible at usernames, but it's a very cool name. So we also have Blue Sumlin's in the house saying hi, everyone. Marcin is joining us. Hello, guys. Good to see so many new people here. Marcin, I agree with you. It's always good to meet new guitar players. Our friend Panu is joining us from Geneva, Switzerland. Let us know whereabouts in the world you're watching from as well, by the way, because we'd love to know. We've had viewers from all over the world, which just blows my mind. So we've had guys from India, guys from Hong Kong, South America, the United States, all across Europe, and literally 5 minutes from my house. It's just, it tickles me pink that we can sit and hang out with guitar players all around the world and talk about all this good stuff. Hi, Steve says, hello all. PT says, hi everyone, have to watch the last few sessions later in the week. Do, but we're going to be touching on some of the content from those last few streams in today's session, because I'm not picking these players at random. They kind of lead on from each other, and there's a particular approach that our man John Petrucci has that leads on from Malmsteen and leads on from Zakk Wylde. So we're choosing these guys for a reason. There's a common thread going on here. Our friend Stefan says, hi there, excited for this session from Sweden. Stefan, it's great to have you. Steve is joining us from Utah. David is from Essex in the UK, around the corner from our studios, no less, where I'll be later in this week shooting some courses for GI+, which I'll be telling you about in just a moment. Oh, wow, look at this. We have from India, no less. Fantastic. So we've got some players from all over the world. If you have not done so already, by the way, make sure that you have a guitar with you for this stream. Make sure you have a guitar in hand, because we're going to be performing some, or rather I'm going to be giving you some ideas to play with, but I'm also going to be testing you on a few things that may be revealing about your own guitar playing. Now, we've had some really cool feedback from these streams already about how they've helped guitar players, kind of like crack some nuts in their picking, so to speak. So hopefully we'll make some breakthroughs for some of you guys today. So grab your guitars if you haven't done so already. Joe Johnson says, excited for today's stream to see your Guthrie Govan and Matteo Mancuso picking strategies videos. All right, so Guthrie I can maybe have a go of. It won't be as clean or ferocious as Guthrie's, but let's be honest, I'm not as clean and ferocious as John Petrucci either, so hey, what are we doing? Matteo Mancuso, on the other hand, I cannot do this thing. That is not for me. That's for somebody else. Maybe ask Giorgio Cerchi about that. But yeah, Matteo Mancuso, what a guitar player. Just frightening, frightening guitar player. So we're going to get cracking with the knack, and we'll get into the meat of today's stream in just a moment. But before we do, just want to take a quick moment to tell you guys about GI+. GI+ is right up here. This is the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive Magazine, where you can check out literally hundreds of hours of lessons. We are doing a special discount on the yearly membership right now. This has been running for a little while, and it's coming to an end soon. So we currently have a 50% off offer. That's 50% off on the yearly membership. So if you sign up for a year, you get it for 50% off, which is pretty outrageous. We can't continue that, so we're going to be bringing that to an end fairly soon. So if you want to take advantage of that deal, links will be in the description. And if you want to support these streams, if you're getting some use out of them, if you think it's something that has helped you with your guitar playing or has just helped you alleviate some boredom on a Monday night, best way you can do it is by checking out GI Plus and maybe thinking about taking out a membership. Of course, you can also give us a thumbs up, drop comments, because the algorithm loves comments, and I love comments too. I love to hear from you guys, and you can share this with your guitar playing friends. We'd like to get this out to as many guitar players as we can. Last week, we cracked triple figures. Can you believe that? We had 100 plus guitar players watching at any given time, which was tremendous. So hopefully we'll do similarly well this week. We'll see. Yngwie is a very popular player. So one final note on this. I'm going to show you this. This is the John Petrucci tech session that we have available for you guys in GI Plus. So this is a full breakdown of John Petrucci's rhythm style, his picking technique, which we'll also be covering a bit of today, but it also covers legato style, his tonal choices, compositional styles, vocabulary, all that sort of stuff. Check it out. It sounds a little bit like this, and it's included in your GI Plus membership. There you go, guys. GI Plus members can learn that tech session in full. It's included as part of your membership, and we also provide you with tab. We provide you with PDFs to go along with it, but it's not just PDFs. We don't just give you a spreadsheet and go, or a sheet rather, and go, hey, best luck. There you go. There is note for note tuition, a breakdown of the rationale that goes along with this stuff. There's some tonal and some gear advice too. So these tech sessions are full masterclasses on the styles of the players in question. So you can check that out as part of your GI Plus membership. Fun fact on that one, by the way, that particular That Music Man, that Majesty that I'm playing there, that is an absolutely outrageous guitar. But I could not get my head around the switching system. So we had to shoot it in two parts because John Petrucci has this particular tonal approach where he'll play on the bridge humbucker for his rhythm ideas and he'll play on the neck humbucker for his solo ideas. But the clean, in this instance, I wanted to use the piezo and I also wanted to use the middle position, which is the John Petrucci clean sound. It's split humbuckers in the middle position, but with a piezo. It sounded really, really great, but I couldn't get to and from that sound in time. So the clean parts you're listening to were actually recorded in a separate performance and we spliced those in. So it's a little bit of a cheat, but I just couldn't get to and from in time. So that's one of those things, even though it's like super ergonomic apparently, just didn't really work for me on the day, but I'm pretty happy with how the rest of it turned out and it was so much fun to put together. I am a bit of a Dream Theater fanboy after all. I did go to school listening to Scenes from a Memory. As so many guitar players my age did. I know Tom Quayle is a huge John Petrucci fan too. So anyway, let's get into the meat of today's session. And the first thing I want to do is I want to encourage you guys to grab a guitar. So if you haven't done so already, get hold of your guitar because we're going to be exploring an exercise. And I want to challenge you to play this exercise in a couple of different ways. So a couple of different ways. By the way, here's a link for where you can get the tech session. If you're interested in learning that stuff in full, there's a link for where you can get it. So get hold of your guitar, grab your guitar. We're going to try playing something. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to pick an arpeggio. It's going to be a really quite simple arpeggio. We're going to be playing an A major. So it's nothing like super crazy. It's like an E-shaped A major bar chord. Now, if you're interested in learning John Petrucci's picking style, I would hope that this bar chord is something that you've come across before. So this is absolutely not for, you know, rank beginners who know G and D and maybe E minor. Nothing wrong with that, by the way. Everybody starts somewhere. But this is for players who at least know this much. So what we're going to do is with our E bar chord, we're going to play every note in this bar chord, starting on the low E string, then the A string, then the D string, G string, high E string, B string, then high E string. We're going to play each note twice, and we're going to pick it as down, up. Starting with the down pick, let's go down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. Now, bonus points. Bonus points. If anybody knows where I got this exercise from, this is a John Petrucci exercise, but I want to see if you guys know where it came from. So I'm not going to tell you just yet, but drop me in the comments if you know where this has come from. So going back to our exercise, starting with a down pick, we're going to play down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. Then we'll do the same thing with an up pick. So we start with an up pick and we'll go up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. So each time we play this, we're going to play with starting with a down pick, then start with an up pick. So let's try that together. Let's try playing down picks first. Let's go down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. Now let's do up picks. Up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. Hopefully one is not drastically harder than the other, but maybe one is a little bit, here we go, the answer's in, it is from Rock Discipline. Have you all watched Rock Discipline, by the way? This is the old John Petrucci REH tape, right? Changed a lot of guitar players' lives, right? Like, it's just, what is this? Oh, my elbow just cracked, and yours may also. So many, like, memeable quotes, right? We won't do the John Petrucci memeable quotes, like, oh, my pickups were made for me by Tony Blair. We won't get into that. That's, if you're a guitar player of a particular age, you'll know what I'm talking about there. So, anyway, memeable quotes aside. So we have this down-up exercise, down-up, 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 down-up. That sort of thing works for us, hopefully at least. We're going to try playing it with two notes per string. We're also going to try playing it with three notes per string. So what I want you guys to do is I want you to see if one is easier than the other. Let's try this together. So let's try doing two notes, starting with a down. Let's try two notes starting with an up. Ooh, again. A little distracted by the comments there. Let's do another one where we play three notes per string. So three picks on each string, starting with a down. So let's go down, up, 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 down, up. Now let's start with an up pick. Now, for good measure, let's do four. So let's do four notes. Let's start with a down pick. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Start with an up pick. So hopefully you've had a chance to go over this, but we're going to try doing it together. We're going to try doing it together along with a drum loop that I've got rigged up here. Let's just throw this on. Nice, easy drum loop. Absolutely nothing to it. And we're going to see if we can do this together. So let's start by playing all those down picks. We're not going to do the full Rock Discipline exercise, by the way. Get hold of a copy of Rock Discipline if you want that. But let's start with down picks. So let's go down with doubles. Let's go. Let's do ups on doubles. Let's go. Now, let's try triples. Triples on each string, starting down. Let's go. Now let's do up. Now let's do fours. Let's go. And up. Let's do it one more time. Doubles. So doubles, here we go. Oh, it's triples. Let's go with doubles. Let's do double starting a nut pick. Here we go. This falls into the next question, which is which one's harder? Triples, let's go. Triples again with the down pick. Triples start with an up pick, let's go. And let's do fours down pick. Fours with an up pick. Ooh, again. Drum loop aside, what I want to know from you guys is if you have tried this, which I hope you have, if you have tried this, I want to know which ones felt easier and which ones felt harder to you guys, right? Which ones felt easier, which ones felt harder? Was it the three notes? Was it the two notes? Was it the four notes? Some of you are going to have different results to other people. Now, we're trying to do it roughly the same speed. Let me know in the comments which one you found easier. Me personally, I was struggling with that upstrokes starting, that two note upstrokes thing, because I have a particular approach that I use for that two notes upstroke thing. But for most players, the most difficult one is going to be the three notes per string idea. That's for most players, but I want to know what was more difficult for you guys, so drop me a comment and let me know, and I will tell you why that might be. So let's get into our picking strategy. So John Petrucci is a very interesting cat when it comes to picking, because he's a very strict alternate picker, but to my mind there are really two John Petrucci picking styles. There is the one note per string Steve Morse inspired arpeggio type playing, which is what you see when our man John Petrucci plays at like kind of a slower pace. Ah, comments are coming in. Marcin says three notes downstrokes was the hardest. Upstrokes most difficult for Stefan Olsen. That's not unusual. Stefan, let me know whether you preferred playing two notes, three notes, or four notes. Four notes. Let me know which one. iSteve says two note. That's probably pretty usual. So iSteve, let me know whether three or four was easier for you. Three or four. Stefan says easier with four notes. Interesting. Okay, so you guys let me know whether you prefer three or four notes. Stefan, we have another one interesting here. Technical 100 says three is easier because you're already on the next note. Now that's an interesting point. Downstrokes, I'm guessing, feels easier. Four is easier with up. David Yates, I've spent too long in the gym, I read that's Dorian Yates. David Yates says, upstroke starts are tough for me and three-note alternate. Yeah, here we go, I'm a downward pick slant man, so I find jumping strings very tough. Interesting. Panu says, two notes per string is the easiest. iSteve says, three notes was the easiest for me. Now, this is very interesting. Let's talk about what's actually going on here. So let's actually dig into this. Yeah, Panu says three is more complex. From a mechanical perspective, it absolutely is. Also, maybe from a timing perspective, too. Three notes downstroke was the easiest, says iSteve. So we're actually going to get away from the idea of the downstroke, upstroke start. That was a bit of a red herring, but I wanted to throw it out because that's something we find in rock discipline. So let's get into what's actually happening here. In fact, let's go to the potato quality close-up picking hand cam. I do apologize about the quality of this particular camera, but I only have two good cameras at hand, so I had to rig up this old Hector down here. But it will do the trick for you guys to see what's going on with my picking hand. Now, let's get into this pick slanting discussion just a little bit. So, in previous weeks, we talked about Zach Wilde and Yngwie Malmsteen as having a particular approach where they prefer to finish lines on an upstroke because with their particular picking posture, like our Zach approach or our Malmsteen approach, where we play. You can tell I'm quite at home with this stuff, by the way, as opposed to the Petrucci thing, but I will try for you guys. These particular approaches work because we adopt a particular posture that's probably commonly referred to as downward pick slanting. Downward pick slanting. Now, what that means, as far as we're concerned, is that the two bones, let's do it on this camera so you guys can see, for a downward pick slant or an upstroke escape, it means the same thing. Downward pick slant, upstroke escape, same thing. What it means is that in terms of our bones, we have the ulnar bone, which is this bone right here, that's in contact with the guitar's body, and the radius, which is this bone here, is not in contact with the guitar's body. So that means that your upstrokes pull away from the guitar's body, and your downstrokes bury into the plane of the strings. Now, this is something that happens if you play in a straight picking path and you want to clear the strings. You can't physically play a perfectly straight picking path and expect it to actually clear from one string to another. It just doesn't happen. You end up stuck. I'll do it on these strings where you guys can see. You end up stuck touching one of the strings either side. You could do it with a curved path, which is something John Petrucci does, but we'll get onto that. So in the example where we're playing down, up, or down, up, down, up on every note, what we're doing is we're using a an upstroke escape or a downward pick slanting approach. So it is that one bone in contact, one bone up in the air. I'll play it with this camera. And watch what's happening. If I play like this, you guys see that? See how the upstrokes pull up in the air, and then I'm free, transition to the next string. Oops. Now, with the upstroke starts on those even notes, what we have to do is we have to do the opposite posture, which is simply by flattening out the picking hand, and we get what's called a downstroke escape pick style of playing, or an upward pick slant is another way you can call it. So what we do here is instead of having just one bone in contact with the guitar's body, we put both bones of the arm in contact with the guitar's body, and that produces a picking angle where the downstrokes clear the string. You can see how clearly this downstroke is lifting up and away from the guitar's body. You guys see that? And the upstrokes, I'll do it on this string so you can see, downstroke lifts up and away, upstroke is now buried, it's resting on my low E string, but that is okay because my downstrokes escape. So for this type of line, where we start with an upstroke, we would use a downstroke escape picking posture, which is both bones. Now, here's the interesting thing. When we do three notes on every string, we have to do something a little bit different. So, here's an interesting point. JD says six string, two notes, five string, four notes. That is very interesting. So depending upon which strings you're playing on, we're finding different notes or different groupings of notes to be easier. That is very interesting. We'll actually get to that in a moment because there's a technical aspect to our man John Petrucci's playing. But anyway, when we get to these three notes per string, this is where things start to get a little weird. So let's talk about what happens if we assumed a downstroke escape posture. Downstroke escape posture like this. So what we have, let's go to this camera. So with the downstroke escape posture, what we would get is we'd play down, up, down, and then our upstroke is way up in the air, downstroke's up, way up in the air even, and we are free to clear this string, ready to get to the upstroke on the next string. That's fine. Down, up, ah. But now we're in trouble, because what you can see there is my upstroke is now buried not just against the string next to the A string, but the wrong side of the A string. So we end up with this. Oh, How do I even get there? It's very hard. If we do the opposite, if we start with a downstroke, or rather an upstroke escape posture, well, the first string change is very hard. So what we could do is start with an up-pick. But now we're buried here. Now, this is a slightly better position to be in, because at least we're on the string we want to play next. But it's still not ideal, because we want to play it with an upstroke and not a downstroke. So what do we do? Well, we change picking postures. So there's a few ways you can do this, right? John Petrucci has a very interesting way of doing this, but let me just show you exactly what's happening here. So if we play our three note per string, this is why many of you will have found this more difficult. If you're not doing this stuff naturally already, which some people do, some people are just naturally adept at this, but let me show you what's going on. So if we play, watch the bones of my arm. If I start with both bones in contact, down, up, down, that's cool. If I play on the next string, up, watch that rotation. Did you catch it? Aha! That, dear friends, is what we would call a double escape picking strategy. Double escape picking strategy. Picking strategies, clues in the title down here. Double escape, again, I did not come up with this stuff. This is not stuff I invented. This is something that guitar players have been doing for centuries, but it's all based on the research of a few guitar players. Troy Grady's been a huge influence for so many players on this. He kind of invented the language on this stuff. But I like to think about this a little bit like the way people share kind of scientific discoveries. So I'm very involved in the strength and conditioning field. People will reference guys like Brad Schoenfeld all the time, let's say, and I kind of think of Troy Grady as, or like Mike Zordos, and I find Troy Grady is a bit like that. He's like the source, we're just here communicating his stuff. So anyway, on we go, and he's also okayed me to talk about this, just saying. So I asked before we talked about this stuff, and he's like, yeah dude, we want to get the message out, which is cool. So anyway, let's keep, here we go. Joe Johnson, guitar player, says, can you get the double escape up to shredding speed? Yes, you absolutely can. Players do. Players do. Six String Jim says, most important question incoming. Best JP signature, Music Man of the Ibanez. Right, okay, like, I grew up with Images and Words and, like, Rock Discipline, so I like the Ibanez one. But I think as a guitar, I think the Music Man one is better. I think it's a better guitar. I actually like the JP more than the Majesty. Personally, I find the Majesty a little too specialized. But it's a very cool guitar, but I love the JP, especially the JP7. It's a very cool guitar. So there, that's the question. So anyway, yes, we absolutely can get the double escape up to shredding speed. Now, what we could do is we could take someone like Paul Gilbert's approach, which is something we'll talk about in a moment, which is literally to rotate the bones of the arm depending upon, like this. You can actually see that happening. And Paul's actually talked about this in one of his lessons. He made the observation that this part of his hand comes up when he plays with upstrokes, and this part of his hand is down when he plays on downstrokes. So what we could do is we could, I'll just throw the backing track on, I'll show you guys what's going on. We're playing in 7/8 because it's Dream Theater, of course we are. It's actually a Tool style backing track, but I thought I'd, you know, I'd use it anyway. It's all that prog. So what we could do, we absolutely could play this shredding speed. Not my personal preferred approach to this stuff. I tend to be more of an economy picker myself, but I feel like as a teacher, I should probably be able to explain these concepts, because the whole core behind this picking strategies idea is it's not about being able to do them all, it's about discovering one that works for you. So this may be the one that works for you. So the Paul Gilbert approach is to do that, and it's literally to have this almost this swan neck type approach. This is something drummers have talked about when they talk about playing the hi-hat. Seen drummers doing this sort of thing when they play the hi-hat. It's this idea of having essentially a stroke like this and then a stroke on the way up. I've heard it referred to as a swan neck. I think there's another name for it. I'm not a drummer. If you ever heard me play the drums, that will be very apparent. That's one way we can do it. But what John Petrucci does, which is very interesting, is he has a primary pick slant. And his primary pick slant is down. So what you'll have seen is you will have seen a lot of these chromatic licks. Here's another exercise from Rock Discipline. So this is the infamous John Petrucci exercise where he talks about getting this up to 200 BPM and then killing yourself. That is not 100% what it is, but the meme is there. The idea is basically we're playing four notes on a string and it goes something like this. Let's see how fast I can get this. My drums are at 110, so if I play this with 32nd notes, it should be 220. Ooh, I've got too many things playing at once. Maybe not. Close. Ooh, very close. Very close. So there you go. Rock discipline exercise at 220 on camera. Which John Petrucci described in the video as being very hard. But he's quite young at the time, and he's probably moved on a bit since then. So yeah, so this particular exercise, this is indicative of John Petrucci's primary pick slant, which is down. Now, this becomes apparent when we see his Steve Morse-inspired arpeggio type lines. If any of you ever tried to play the Glass Prison, for example, the arpeggios from the Glass Prison, they're a nightmare because it's alternate picked arpeggios, which seems to be this magic trick that nobody else does. Steve Morse does it, but nobody else apparently, and it might look something like this. Let's just throw the prog back track on again. So very hard, real tough, really, really tough. Absolutely not the way that I would choose to play that stuff. But you also see it on lines like this, where we might be playing these. This is in the tech section, by the way. Lines like this, where we might be playing these. That's really tough. I tire out very quickly playing that stuff. But what's interesting here is this gives us some insight into the John Petrucci. Excuse me, not executing that very well, by the way, but hey, it's difficult. It's a tough thing to do. But this gives us some insight into the John Petrucci double escape strategy, because what we essentially have here, which is really interesting, is we have this double escape on every stroke. Now, the way John Petrucci does it is he starts with his primary pick slant, which is down, and then when it's time to escape an up pick, such as after a down pick, we have this rotation of the hand. And you'll actually see this in his picking hand. You'll see it right here where we get this rotating of the hand. Now, if we play these lines a little slower, and if you watch things like Rock Discipline, when John Petrucci is demonstrating this stuff, what we might get is this idea. And you would have seen this rotating pick movement. And at this kind of speed, that's no problem at all. But as soon as we get to faster tempi, we have this very interesting thing where what, again, John will do is, instead of rotating on every pick stroke, like this, rotating away, he'll rotate when he changes strings. So we'll start with this downward pick slant bias, because that's where he tends to start things, and you'll get this idea of down, up, down, rotate, up, down, up and rotate, down, up, down and rotate, up, down, up and rotate, down, up, down and rotate, up, down, up and rotate. Now, it's not as discreet is that. It's not as discreet as just rotating on the last stroke. The rotation actually happens in a slightly smoother fashion on every individual string. And it's almost like what he's doing is playing this with this rotated approach, but just sneaking a couple of extra pick strokes in on the way. This. So from a practical perspective, what we can take a look at is the idea of having a primary pick slant. Now, this is not something you can say of someone like Paul Gilbert. Paul Gilbert doesn't really have a primary pick slant. But for someone like John Petrucci, if you watch him play and you look at his hand position, his hand posture is very, very interesting because it's very clearly radius up. It's very clearly this hand posture. So he's coming from this Zach Wild, Yngwie Malmsteen, like technical approach school, I guess. But he's just figured out a way to rotate his hand in such a way that it allows him to escape on downstrokes, which is not something that Malmsteen or Zach Wild necessarily do very often. Now, from a practical perspective, Let's take a look at some lines that we might use. Interesting. It's close to scalpel picking. I guess it kind of is. I guess scalpel picking would be the idea of using the pick a little bit like a scalpel, I guess. So that's an interesting way of thinking about it. In terms of the actual movement, what's interesting here is it's entirely wrist. It's all wrist, which is quite hard to do and still rotate your forearm. So it's kind of a mechanical puzzle that Petrucci is solving when he's doing this stuff. But it's really, really interesting to see. So if we throw some lines out, let's try playing some lines or some sequences that might use this idea. So let's start with one that goes a little like this. Let's play something in, let's go to A minor for argument's sake. We'll keep A minor because it's a nice key. And this might be a fun lick that you guys can play. This thumb lick that you can play. So if I quickly throw on, let's find an A minor backtrack. Let's do the ballad. So this is our A minor ballad. We're going to go to the neck position because of course we are. Let's try a lick that might go something like this. So we have some chromatic elements. We have the sequencing thing. Very, very John Petrucci idea. One more time. So, let's talk about what's actually going on there. This sequencing thing that we have going on here. Oh, we've got some really interesting things going on here. Pronosupination versus radia and ulna deviation. Wow. Very, very interesting. And so this is pronation and supination versus radial and ulna deviation. Yeah, absolutely. This is movement language. So this is the language we use when we describe movements. I'm really pleased to see people talking about this in the comments. That is very, very cool indeed. So we could call it that. So we could essentially call it supination, which is the idea of turning the hand out. It comes from the Latin supplicate, which means to beg. So opening of the hand, supine, which is this position. We have a supinated position and then a prone or a pronated position here. I just like to think about the bone contact because the radius is always in contact with the guitar unless you're in a very, very unusual position like this where it's just the ulna in contact. That is very unusual. So I like to think about it as one bone for this or two bones for this. I just find it a little easier to communicate. Anyway, back to our line. So what we're doing here, real quick, I'm just going to show you this as a sequencing idea. So we're playing a line in this position of the A minor scale. So we have essentially starting on the minor 7th, we have frets 3, 5, and 7, which you might think of as a stretch shape. Then we have 3, 5, 7 again, 3, 5, 7 on the next strings. From here, we have 4, 5, 7, 5, 6, 8, and then finally 5, 7, 8, but we're actually going to play these as chromatic scales, which we'll get to in a minute. So what we're doing here in this little line is we're playing a two-sequence idea on each string pair. What I mean by two-sequence idea is we essentially play we play a sequence that goes from the lowest note to the highest note on one string, touches on the lowest note of the next string, and then comes back down. So I think about this as low to next string low, and then back again. From here, we play with a sequence that I'd call six notes up, which would go like this. Six notes up. So what we could do here is we could play down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. And that would work. Now, this is not something that would work with our Zakk Wylde or our Malmsteen-esque downward upstroke escape line of playing because it just doesn't fly. Because what we could have, we could do the sweep. We could play the Malmsteen sweep, but it just doesn't really work because now we're on the wrong side of this string. We can't get back here in time to play a note on the low E string. So we have to do this with double escape. This is a line that can only be played with double escape if you want to pick every note. So the way we do it is we play down, up, down and rotate, up and rotate again. You'll see John Petrucci play this. There'll be this momentary dive as he reaches for this upstroke. From here, six notes up carries on just the way we'd expect it to be. It would be down, up, down, up, down, up, with a different rotation of the hand for each of these pick escapes. Hopefully that's making sense. So we're playing this double sequence on every string pair. Then we get to here. From here, we've played an upstroke. We're primed to start with the downstroke. We're going to play chromatic scales. So we're going to get down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. We can slide up here to a nice big screaming bend. Once again, that lick is something like this. Now, what's interesting here is some of you guys are going to find this equally hard throughout, but some of you are going to find the chromatic passage way easier than the sequenced passage, and others still will find the sequenced passage way easier than the chromatic passage. So I'm going to encourage you to play with that a little bit. I am going to throw it on. Let's try doing this real quick. Let's try playing together. If you have that lick, at least at some speed, let's try playing the sequenced passage, which is going to give us... or at speed, we get. Again. My own pick and vices are coming in here. Now let's try the chromatic passage, which goes... which you might play is... let's try one after another. So sequence passage. Chromatic passage. Let's try them together. One ending in an upstroke. Again, we go. So, what I'm curious from you guys is I'm curious to know which one you found easier. And whether you found the whole thing, maybe you found the whole thing a little too much, and that's fine, that's okay. But if you're playing it at a slightly slower tempo, that's still fine. I'm curious as to whether you found the sequenced idea harder, or whether you found the chromatic idea harder, or whether you found them both equally easy or equally difficult. This is going to be hopefully fairly revealing of your own playing biases. So Blue Sumlin says, prefer chromatic passage. I agree. Personally, I find the chromatic passage easier because it's more in line with my own picking strategy. Whereas the sequence passage, that's a little more challenging. I don't find that quite as easy with my own picking strategy. You guys may feel differently about this. Strings and Things says, sweet run indeed. For those guys who don't know Strings and Things, that is Ernie Ball in the UK, who are kind enough to supply me with all of my strings. I got a whole drawer of them here. We've got, what do we got? Let's pick some out at random. Let's see. Yeah, Cobalt Slinkies. Very, very cool. Yeah, just random strings. I'm very lucky to have all these strings. It's very, very cool. So here we go. Joel says, I much prefer the sequence section starting with an upstroke. Now, this is interesting. This may hint at a particular kind of default pick slant, or a particular primary pick slant. So maybe you find it, because you're going to have to do the sequence. If you can play the sequence part, you're going to have to do it with double escape. There's no two ways around it. So you are doing double escape, but the fact that you're starting with a particular pick stroke is easier. That could be, it could be down to, again, a particular primary primary picks landing. Nick James says, all of my fingers have just run away screaming. I know how you feel. I'm just kind of throwing myself under a bus with this stuff, because like I say, I am Mr. Economy Picking, but whatever. Ah, Jonathan Cordy's in the stream. Hey dude, how you doing? I grew up in Petrucci Run, so the sequence bit is easier. Interesting. That is very, very interesting. Again, this is something that varies from player to player, but again, the whole idea of this picking strategy series is not necessarily, again, to be a master of all of these things, but to be to kind of find one that works for you, so to speak. Here we go. I, Steve, says, I always trip with chromatic passages with my left hand. No idea why. Strange Things says, I'm just a dude in Melbourne. I don't sell Strange Things. Well, there you go. Strange Things, it's good to have you on board. And yeah, I still appreciate your comment. Thank you very much. But Strange Things are still Ernie Ball in the UK. So I assumed it was you guys. Strange Things, great to have you on. So listen, we have talked at length about the John Petrucci double escape picking strategy. We're going to go to the Q&A because otherwise we're going to run out of time, and I always do this. But just to sum up the approaches that we have so far, I'm going to throw the backing track back on. We have the Zach Wilde tune up a string double escape, single escape idea, which you might think of as a permanent downward pick slant. We have the Malmsteen asymmetrical approach, which is this idea of essentially playing a comedy pick in this direction and playing a combination of legato and picking in this direction. Incidentally, that licks quite cool. We'll come back to that in a moment. Now we have this John Petrucci idea of essentially having a primary downward pick slant, but also being able to get into this upward pick slant. So we might have this approach. Incidentally, let's try some of that, because that was quite good from last week. So we talked about this Malmsteen lick last week. I'm actually going to play it in... I'm going to play it using A harmonic minor, even though we're in the D. This is going to give me a D Dorian sharp form, which is a very cool sound. Now this Malmsteen lick, if we play it like this, we play it like Malmsteen, what we get is this idea of essentially playing, well, the legato in the first bit, the way John Petrucci would play this, with a full alternate picking strategy, would be something like that. And the way I would play it would be the full economy picking strategy. So the point with this is we've literally just looked at three ways of playing that run. Three ways of playing that run. They all sound about the same. They all sound like the sound of a pick, but what's crucial is some of them are going to be great for some players, some of them are great for other players, some of them for other players still. It's not about mastering all of these. It's about finding a strategy that works for you and building a complete picking style around that. So let's go to the Q&A. I'm going to give you guys just a very brief moment to drop me some more questions. So if you've got some questions, drop them in the comments. I would love to hear from you guys. We'll do the Q&A in just a couple of moments. I'm going to throw the Mark Tremonti backing track on. Why not? Incidentally, all these backing tracks are available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. So if you're watching this on YouTube, give us a subscribe. We upload new tracks all of the time. Drop me questions in the comments and I will answer them momentarily. But for the time being, I'm just going to play for a little bit because I've not done any just playing for a little while. So let's do some freeform, picky, monstrous, whatever. Here we go. We'll be right back. full of fun. Thought I'd sneak a few Malmsteen-type ideas and a few Zach Wild-type ideas in there as well, because these are the players we've discussed in previous streams. So let's get to the Q&A. We've got some great questions coming in already. I am going to try my best to get to as many of them as we can. So let's see. First question, Jonathan Cordy, says, where did your economy picking style come from? Pure convenience is where it came from. To be completely honest, I didn't think too hard about it. I just picked, and that's kind of what came out. But I was learning a lot of Malmsteen at the time. So learning a ton of Malmsteen. So I got into the Malmsteen approach of playing these kind of lines in the ascending direction. And I thought initially that what he did in the descending direction was just flip it on his head. So quick, once again, for argument's sake, that inverse Malmsteen, if you want to call it that, let's go to the pick and hand cam. If we played like the Malmsteen way of doing this, playing in the reverse direction, would essentially be an economy picking approach. So Malmsteen has this interesting way of playing where it's economy picking this way, but it's Zach this way, if that makes sense. Guess not Zach, because Malmsteen was active before Zach Wild was, I think. I don't know how early Zach started. Who knows? But yeah, certainly in the public consciousness more than Zach stuff. Strength and Things says, I missed the start of the lesson. Where can we see a rerun of the Zach and Malmsteen licks, please? Epic playing. Thank you very much, first of all. You can check out all of the replays of these streams on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. So if you go to Guitar Interactive Magazine, on YouTube, you can check out the reruns of the Zach lesson and the Malmsteen lesson. And of course, if you want to see the tech sessions that go along with those, because we have full in-depth tech sessions, you can find those on GI Plus. So a bit like the John Petrucci tech session that I'm going to show you guys again in a moment. So let's get to some more questions. Here we go. Let's see. We got so many. Here we go. Let's get into this one. Here we go. So Pheasant Plucker. That's a username to trip people up, but hey. Pheasant Plucker, although we're late into the stream now, we're like nearly an hour in. I don't think YouTube's listening for swears anymore. But, you know, people might be watching with kids. Who knows? If you're watching a John Petrucci lesson with your kids, I mean, I guess. Cool. I don't know. Maybe you have really cool kids. Who knows? Anyway, so swearing aside, Pheasant Plucker says, when you change pick slant direction, do you alter how you hold the pick at all, or is it all on the wrist? Now, yes and no. Yes and no. I will alter the way I hold the pick slightly, but that's more to maintain the angle of the pick on the string, because what I want is I want a fairly consistent angle, and players just do this by instinct, we just by listening. So I want a fairly consistent angle of attack as far as the rotation of the pick on the string, whether it's like this or whether it's like this. So I tend to play with a little bit of pick angle, as most people do, because it sounds a little nicer and it feels a little nicer. So I will change the way I'm holding the pick when I change pick slants, but not to change pick slants, if that makes sense. So to change pick slants, I do that all from a rotation of the wrist. And for me, the way I think about this is it's all about which bones are in contact with the body. So if just the radius is in contact with the guitar's body, that to me is downward pick slant. That's my primary pick slant when I'm playing rock stuff. It's my ascending pick slant. It's a directional approach that I tend to use. That's my primary pick slant when I'm ascending. When I'm descending, I'll go here. Have both bones in contact with the body, and that produces the pick slant. So one bone in contact, both bones in contact. One bone in contact, both bones in contact. Hopefully that makes sense. So that's that. Let's keep going. Who else do we have? Blue Summerlin says, use a mixture of each. Yeah, you absolutely can. And to be honest, many, many players will. We're using players that are archetypes here to sort of talk about these approaches, but the majority of players will use a blended approach where there's kind of a little bits of each depending upon kind of what's going on. Here we go. Sacred Godslayer. Wow, that's a name and a half. Just learning even the ones you won't ever use will make you better at the ones you will use. Yes. Now, this is a very interesting concept because it will. because of the way skill learning works. So the way skill learning, specifically motor skill learning, works is that we get better at a particular skill by solving problems that are similar to the skill we're trying to develop. So by trying to develop these other picking strategies, they're actually going to reinforce the one that you use all of the time, because it will kind of strengthen those motor pathways that you get from your primary picking approach. So yeah, it's absolutely worth you delving into economy picking if you tend to be a double escape alternate picker. Vice versa, it's worth you working on just upstroke escape pentatonic ideas if you are primarily an economy picker, let's say. It really does all feed into the same thing, but it's also, you know, it's worth noting that you don't have to use all of these in your playing to make the most of it. Here's an interesting one. Hussein says, I think the best picking style is free from all sorts of pattern without calculation, up or downstroke. I guess economy would be best. Now, you're kind of right. You're kind of right here, my man. But the issue with this is that not everybody agrees on what the best picking style is. Now, case in point. So, you guys probably know already, so my hobby outside of playing guitar is I'm a recreational powerlifter. So the competition of bench press, squat, and deadlift. There is much argument about, you know, what is the strongest way to bench press. For a lot of people, it's going to be a wide grip. Anecdotally, some people are stronger with a close grip. It's kind of down to preference more than anything else. You can make some general rules, but some players are going to be freer with one particular style versus another. So it might not be economy picking. For me, I feel freer when I tend to play with a generally economy approach. That generally works better for me. But by the same token, there are some players out there who feel freer with the approach that I'm not so keen on, or not so good at, which is this, which ironically is the one I've been doing for you guys this whole time. But it's this idea of having a double escape. This idea of basically having a full-on double escaped, everything is down then up kind of way of playing. Some people just take well to that. So I guess what I can extrapolate from this is the best picking style is the one that makes you, dear viewer, freer to play whatever it is that you want to play. And we're going to go back to our usual adage here, which is that on average, certain players will be better with one style or another, but you are not an average, you are an individual. And finding the one that works for you is the one. That's the move. So anyway, let's keep going. More questions. We'll get through a few more. I'll maybe run a little longer here. We'll get through a few more because we've got some really good questions in here. Here we go. Does the angle of escape change your angle of attack? Yes, it does, by definition, because we're trying to pick in straight lines as much as we can. So if you are trying to escape with a down pick, you have to, therefore, attack in this direction. Or trying to escape with an up pick, let's say, you have to attack in this direction. There's no two ways about it. You can flatten that out a little bit. So you can flatten that out so it just clears the string. That's fine. But if I then try to escape with a down pick, you will notice the angle of attack has changed. It has to change, because otherwise we're not going to be able to get the stroke that we want to escaping. So yeah, it does. It's a great question, by the way. Very, very good question. Let's keep on going. Oh, same guy, Joe Johnson, guitarist. You got some great questions today, my man. What's your pick depth and angle? So pick angle, which is this rotation. I tend to play with maybe a 30 degree angle on the pick. And as far as depth, it's not like super shallow. It's not the absolute tip of the pick, because I like a little bit of, I mean, I'm a rock player after all, so I like a bit of aggression, I like a bit of clatter. It's not crazy deep, but it's maybe, oh, let's say, well, I'll just show it to the camera. It's that deep. Can you guys see? So my thumb's normally in contact with the string, because I like that squawky kind of sound. So it's maybe that deep from the thumb. So just a little bit of depth, but not like crazy, crazy depth. Sometimes I will dig in like that though for certain lines. So, Guthrie Govan has come up in the comments a number of times. Let's do Guthrie. Why not, eh? Why not? So, Joel Hume, as what picking strategies Guthrie use? Okay, Guthrie's an interesting cat because of a variety of reasons, not least because he's probably the greatest living guitar player. I will make that statement. Although there are people coming up who are equally terrifying. Matteo Mancuso was mentioned a little while ago, and just what a phenom he is. Anyway, Guthrie Govan, I think most people would agree, is probably the greatest guitar player walking the earth. I reckon. Just from a purely facility on the instrument perspective, but also musically, fabulous musician. We don't need to qualify this stuff. But Guthrie's an interesting guy, because what Guthrie did for a long time was claimed to be a primary alternate picker, when in actual fact, what Guthrie really is, he's an economy picker. So Guthrie tends to play economy picking, and just doesn't even really realize that he's doing it. Now, the only reason we know this is because somebody filmed him and showed it to him when, well, actually, I think you'll find what you're doing is economy picking. But the point with this is it's transparent to him. He didn't really pay attention. And the cool thing about it is he was such a cool guy. He just went, oh, that's interesting. Well, maybe I'm an economy picker. There's no real right or wrong about this. Now, people will say that economy picking versus alternate picking has a sound. I don't think that's necessarily true. I don't think it has a true. It's true. I think there are two sounds you can make on the guitar. There is the sound of pick, and there is the sound of finger. And that's it. Dynamics within that, absolutely. But if you're picking the string, it has a sound. If you're playing with fingers, it has a sound. And that's it. Guthrie described it as the sound of plastic and the sound of meat. And I tried to get him to call his next album The Sound of Meat, but apparently it's spoken for. So maybe the third album will be called The Sound of Meat. Who knows? On we go. Guthrie uses alien technology strategies. He absolutely does, especially for his lines. He also has like one of the face huggers from Alien for a left hand, which I think is absolutely unfair. Here we go. He's an interesting one. Mark Renish says, what's a fundamental left hand noise control technique for me to focus on? Mainly the index finger. It's often placed first and moving up and down the strings. It is if you start with the first finger, but I don't like this idea of the first finger being like nature's capo and just kind of staying there, if you know what I mean. I don't like that idea a lot. Incidentally, like as if by magic, who would turn up in the stream but David Beebe. Hi, Dave. How you doing? It's lovely to have you on board. A fabulous guitar player and a fantastic human being, no less. Yeah, I don't like this idea that the first finger is somehow something that should always be on the strings. We talked about this before in our technical hotfixes live stream, where we talked about the idea of first finger. But you can check out Tom Quayle's lessons about this, about the lazy first finger syndrome. I've just noticed this light has gone off, but whatever. So yeah, lazy first finger syndrome, that is something Tom talks about. What this does is it does kind of make the idea of muting a little more tricky. We'll go back to Mark's question, but to be completely honest, I feel like muting is something that, yes, it's important, but people can over mute, in my opinion. We can get so fixated on muting that we can end up with this like super, super, super like tense technique as we kind of like have this first finger planted because it must be muting the strings. In reality, a light touch when you cross to the next string with whatever finger is sufficient to mute a note. So if I try playing my G string, for example, and then I fret a different note on my D string, let's say, I don't need to keep that finger there to stop the G string from ringing out. I can touch, and that is enough to mute. Now, when I'm sustaining a note, I will sometimes have a mute going on with the inside of this left-hand finger. Let's go to the close-up cam, you guys can see. Sometimes there'll be a mute there, but often what I'll do is I'll also cheat, and I'll do this, where I'll mute with my right hand. To be completely honest, though, I feel like a big part of the muting thing is just not making the noise in the first place. And that comes down to not being super violent with the guitar. Like, if I mute as hard as I can, but I still absolutely slam onto the guitar's neck, it makes noise whether I want it to or not. But if I'm a little bit more drakey with my playing, let's say, especially with the legato thing, let's say, because we're talking about left-hand stuff. If I strike rather than, and what I mean by strike is, like, it's almost like a tap like that. First of all, it's more relaxed, but also it means I'm not actually producing that much noise from my playing to start with. So. You can tell I'm more of a legato guy than an alternate picking guy, but even still, it doesn't produce that much noise to begin with. Whereas if I absolutely leather the guitar, which I sometimes do live, it's almost, it's quite hard to keep the noise down. Keep the noise down, say my neighbours every Monday night. It's quite hard to keep the noise floor down because I'm producing so much noise just from the act of actually playing. So maybe playing with a slightly lighter touch is a strategy for this. It's a thought. I realize that's a very swervy answer, Mark, but hopefully that answers your question. Who else do we have? Let's just do a couple more, one or two more. Why not? Nick James says, are you using a heavy rolled edge pick or a sharper edge pick? I am not using my pick of preference, and here's why. My pick of preference is this guy. This is an Ultex Jazz 3. Let me tell you why I'm not using that. Right, there are some guesses, but it's a bit of a meme on these streams. The reason I don't use that Ultex Jazz 3, which has quite a rolled edge, I'm using this guy, which is a white Tortex Jazz 3. The reason I'm using this is so that you, dear viewers, can see what I'm doing. That's literally it. So I've grabbed a white pick, even though it's not my favorite, just so you guys can see what's going on. So we've got kind of like a bit of a flat edge on the pick here. It's got a bit of a point, so it's got a sharp tip, but it's got kind of like a flat edge on this side. Doesn't make that much difference, really. What's the best guitar for someone young to learn on? Whatever guitar makes them excited. So, like, take them to a guitar shop and let them go, ooh, I like that. The guitar that they want to pick up because it looks really cool sat in the corner of the room is the best guitar, in my opinion. I am duty-bound to say PRS because I'm a PRS artist. But in reality, the guitar that they bond with visually is going to be the one, I think, personally, because it's going to make them want to pick it up and play. They'll go, that's cool, I can't. We've all had that. We've had a guitar in the corner where you go, I can't wait to play that guitar. That's what we want, I think. Tin Man Tin, love a bit of Petrucci. Thinks playing on Images and Words is the best, though, more melodic. I grew up on that stuff. For me, it's Scenes from a Memory, but that's the best Dream Theater album, in my opinion. Henick, have you seen anything about Josh Meader's picking style? That is the subject for another whole stream, I think. But yeah, outrageous stuff. Hussein is right. I kind of agree. David Beebe says, enjoying these picking strategy streams. Thank you very much, my man. It is very kind. We need to catch up. We haven't spoken in the longest time because, well, the world's been closed. So yeah, we are absolutely long overdue a bit of a catch up. Who else do we have? Rotel says, loving these streams focused on famous plays picking strategies. Any chance of doing picking in the style of Ronnie Pickering, alternate Pickering? You know, what's that hanging from your headstock? Last couple of questions. That is a small charm that I found on the floor somewhere when I was on tour. It looked cool. This guitar is kind of the plain Jane of my collection, so I thought a little headstock charm would be kind of, it would spruce it up a little bit. I think it's kind of cool. I went and put charms on all my guitars. Some of them fell off. I still quite famously have a feather on my Soap Bar PRS, which is kind of pretty ostentatious, but I like it. Anyway, absolutely, Mark says absolutely, and it's a relief since we're trying to lighten up my touch. Light touch, man, light touch is good. I can say this, like, so today, again, I'm training for a mock powerlifting meet. Today was a heavy deadlift session. My grip is pretty strong. Guitar is not about grip strength. Having a stronger grip did not make me a better guitar player. Having a lighter touch absolutely did. So anyway, guys, thank you so much for having me. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive. You can check out the full John Petrucci tech session as part of your GI Plus membership. It is included in the membership, as is new stuff that we're uploading all the time. We've got courses coming on slide, metal rhythm guitar. We have the ever elusive course on the modes. Oh no. We're going to be doing that. I'm going to be trying to do at least a fairly definitive way of kind of pitching this from the rock player's perspective. That's coming. We've got stuff on technique. We've got stuff on theory. We've got stuff on vocabulary. All of that good stuff. I am going to play for you guys for a little bit, and then we're going to throw the John Petrucci tech session on for you guys to check out one more time. It's been a blast. Let's just go back over our 7-8 prog thing. It's really a tool style track, but I'm going to play some proggy lines on it all the same, or prog-esque. And let's just see what happens. Let's see what comes out. Notes, all of the fun of there. My name is Nick Jennison for GI. If you want to check out the full John Petrucci tech session, you can do so at the link in the description. For GI Plus, it sounds like this. I'll see you guys next week.